Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. How are you? Everybody ready to go? Is that a real beard, Dumbledore? Is that the real thing? Look at this guy. Let's give that beard a big round of applause. I aspire to be like you, sir. I aspire to be like you. Who's enjoying themselves here at Celebration of Harry Potter 2017? Very nice. So glad you guys came out this afternoon, this evening, to check out all the great panels that we've had throughout the day. And now we're going to bring up Miss Mary GrandPré. She is the illustrator of all 7 books in the iconic Harry Potter series by J.K. Rowling. Her illustration of Harry Potter made the cover of Time magazine. Her work has also appeared in The New Yorker, also in The Atlantic Monthly and The Wall Street Journal, and her paintings and pastels have been shown in art galleries across the United States. Harry Potter fans, please welcome Mary GrandPré to the stage. Hello, Mary, the stage is yours.
Hey, thank you so much. It's so fun to be here, and I cannot wait to share some of what I'm going to show you tonight. As Scott said, I am the illustrator of the Harry Potter books. I've been illustrating books for a long time, but I've never illustrated a book like Harry Potter. The characters, the settings, the creatures are so magical and mystical. It just kind of took me on a journey that I never thought I'd be on. Tonight, I want to show you some behind-the-scenes sketches and talk a little bit about the process of my work and how, as an illustrator, I tried to bring J.K. Rowling's writing to life in a visual way. So, let's start off with the cover. When I first was approached by Scholastic, we had no idea this was going to be such a big series, such a big book. And I just received a call from the art director, David Saylor, who had seen some of my children's books. He liked the way that I used color and light and atmosphere, and he thought maybe I'd be a good match for this magical series. So he sent the manuscript, and the manuscript came to my house, and I read the manuscript. It was a beautiful story. It was kind of hard to put down, as you know. And I kind of fell in love with this character and all of the things that he had to deal with at the end of the steps, under the stairs, and the Dursleys, and his power that he learned about, and his journey to Hogwarts, and all the first-time things that we kind of look back on in that first book. It was so wonderful. And so I couldn't resist, and I said, yes, please, let me be the illustrator. So the way this works is I started with some sketches. One of the sketches that I did was actually this. This was not obviously used. But I like to give the art director some different things to pick from. So I chose about 3 different scenes in the book to focus on. And this was just one of them that I really liked because I haven't loved it much. And Fluffy is such an amazing character, such a creature that we can't deny his charm. So I submitted this one. When I do my sketches, I work on tracing paper with pencil. And so I can take another sheet of tracing paper on top of that and kind of redraw as many times as I need to get the drawing that I like. So, but the drawing, of course, that was chosen was the one of Harry flying through the archways there. And of course, we had to think about what the type should look like. I asked David if he wouldn't mind if I designed some typefaces just to see if I could make it work with the illustrations. I chose kind of a gothic type and kind of put my own twist on it with the lightning bolt and came up with this, which has become very popular. Every time I know that there's a book coming, every time I know that there's another book is coming, I start drawing character sketches of Harry. I like to focus on what kinds of expressions he might have, what kind of gestures he has, how he's aged a year. That's kind of a challenging part, is to draw a character year after year, but make sure that they look a little bit older, but they still look like themselves. And so I start drawing him before I even get the manuscript, just to get warmed up, because it's a process that takes a lot of time and dedication to get it right. And Harry is, I really want to do justice to who he is, so I take my time with that. So I've got some different expressions showing here and some different gestures as well, different types of clothing, and just trying to get how he changes as he grows, his proportions, and the way he kind of carries himself. And eventually the second book came along, and we're still kind of staying in that same color palette at this point, kind of this jewel tone color palette, because we kind of feel that the stories have this kind of magical, kind of jewel kind of atmosphere about it, really rich colors, rich descriptions, and not really focusing too much on one color here, but just making them very colorful and kind of grabbing your attention. On this cover, you know, on the first cover, as you remember, we showed Harry with a little bit of Dumbledore in the background and the owl and some little bits and pieces that I like to tuck in and hide. On this piece, we really took a more broad scene, including Harry's friends, because we find out how important his friends are to him in book one, and then in book two, it follows through. So it was really fun to include Ron and Hermione this time, and to show that strong friendship, that strong connection between them, and kind of, you know, helping each other out. So, and also on each book cover, you can see that I hand letter the secondary part of the title and the Chamber of Secrets. There, it's all hand lettered. It's on the same piece of art as the actual figures and all of the other stuff. And so I felt kind of good about that cover. And then actually the Harry Potter part of that is a separate piece that the printer puts into the piece. Some sketches that you haven't seen. Now these are sketches that I actually did for the book cover 5, Harry Potter and the Order of the Phoenix. And this was kind of a moody, things were getting kind of emotional and moody in this book. Kind of mysterious, and so I was trying to bring that to Harry's expression, and then you can kind of see that he's opening a door on that first one, excuse me, on the second one, he's going down this long hallway, about to open a door, and the third one, he's opened it, and he's looking at something, but we don't know what. So that kind of tension is what I was going after. The middle piece, however, you might remember, actually ended up as one of the chapter headings in book 5. And this is the sketch that we actually settled on, with Harry looking over his shoulder, and he's in that circular room with all of those candles and smoke. And this kind of cover where it wraps around the back really offers the illustrator the chance to show other characters and other parts of the setting, and you can just kind of weave it into a little more depth of the story. So I actually show Mad-Eye Moody, Lupin, and Tonks in this one. And it's fun to show, to have those back covers, to really have a place to show the characters we might not see otherwise, or that might not get to be in color otherwise. So that was really fun. By the time we got to the fifth book, we had decided, the art director and I had talked a bit more about our color palette. Like books 1, 2, and 3 were really rich jewel tones like I've been talking about, and then before the Goblet of Fire was kind of green and gold, we were deciding it was time to really let 5, 6, and 7 kind of have their own look. And let the color reflect the mood of that particular book. And so we thought blue was a good color for this book, with, you know, the kind of mood that was going on in the story. This is one of my favorite covers, I think. And then the scene at Grimwald's where that, you know, the walls open up and offer the secret place where they meet. Again, just really going in with my pencils and tracing paper, tracing over many, many times to get as much detail as I can. And there's little things you can see that are tucked into the grass. I think there's a burning letter. There's Dumbledore's glasses are dangling off the little iron gate there. There's people flying in, and then there's some little shadows in the windows in the building. And then the final piece, of course, in blues again to go with book five. And the, remember the red and green lights in the sky and how they kind of twinkle? So we brought a little bit of color in. And this piece was actually done for a special editions of book five. And that was really fun. I love those kind of monotone, moody colors. I think it lets the light really glow. I love that. At book six, do you guys remember the scene where Harry and Dumbledore were in the cave and Dumbledore took his wand and kind of scorched the side of the cave to open that doorway? I thought that would make a good scene. And I kind of, sometimes it's hard to come up with what scene to show on the cover. We do a lot of discussion about that. The art director and the editor, Arthur Mead, and myself, we really talk about what scene we want to show because we don't want to give away too much of the story. We just want to kind of show the emotion, the feeling of it. We want to pick a scene that's enticing and it really makes people wonder what it's about. So I wasn't sure if this was going to be mysterious enough or grabbing enough, so we went on and worked on some more sketches and came up with Harry and Dumbledore looking into the pensive. And again, the back cover served a fun place for me to show Ron, Hermione, and that's Jenny on the back with the sign in the sky. Just adding to that feeling again, but still letting his friends be there. So this was the green and purple color palette for this one. We thought that was an interesting combination for the Half-Blood Prince. And the last cover, Harry Potter and the Deathly Hallows. This I think maybe my favorite cover because it was my last cover and I was, very attached to the Harry Potter series and really knowing that this was going to be the last book, it was kind of bittersweet. I mean, it was setting him off. It was, I really need to do a good job on this cover. I mean, I feel that way with everyone, but this had a kind of a special meaning because it was going to be the last one for me. And so I approached the art director about, gosh, do you think we could maybe show Dumbledore? I mean, I'm sorry, not Dumbledore, but Voldemort on the back somehow? Because we hadn't shown Voldemort. We didn't want to really ever show Voldemort because he's so evil. And, part of that fear we feel of Voldemort is because we don't know what he looks like. But we're reading the book and we kind of have our own thing going in our head what he looks like. And we need the reader to be able to have that. So we didn't really want to force our view of what Voldemort looked like. But I thought, well, maybe if I keep him mysterious enough, that still gives the reader their own interpretation. We could do that. Do you think we could do that on the cover? And so that became the discussion. And we finally decided it would work and would be okay. So that was really exciting to be able to actually put him back there and just show a little bit of his face, just a little bit of that glint in the eye and those creepy hands. And then to decide, what is Harry doing? He's reaching for something. When the viewer's going to look at this before they read it, they're not going to know what he's reaching for, but they're going to know something is coming. Something's up there. What is it? So leaving that question and that kind of tension was important to us. Another thing that I don't know if you guys noticed, but do you notice anything about this cover that relates to the first cover? The arches? The curtain, absolutely, it's the curtain. The curtain was just a way for us to kind of go back to book one and honor the whole series in a way. Kind of tie the last book to the first book. And it kind of framed it up nicely. And I like the kind of the symbol of a curtain, something behind the curtain, something exposed. And that was fun. On the chapter headings, I'm working on tracing paper with pencil, many, many sketches go by and many end up in the trash can because I'm just, you know, trying to get the right one going. But so I just, I'm going to show you some of my favorite sketches. But these aren't actually finals. The finals are charcoals because I want to get some water. Thank you. The actual final pieces are done with charcoal on printmaking paper, whereas the final covers are pastels on printmaking paper. So they're kind of fragile and they have to be handled carefully, but they give a really nice glowing effect. So I liked this series because it's of the three friends, Harry, Hermione, and Ron, and I always like showing them together because they have such a bond, and even their facial expressions and the way they kind of group together is so important, I think. And one of my favorite characters, just singular characters, of course, is Snape. I mean, who doesn't love him? And he's such a fun guy to draw because of his expression. He's so dramatic and so lovely, and I really enjoy him. Creature who's actually, what a guy. I mean, you know, Dobby, of course, came first, and Dobby is the one that inspired the way Creature would look for me. But I have to say, J.K. Rowling's descriptions of her characters and her places and her creatures are so right on. Just the way that she writes about them, they're super easy for me to draw and to envision. She gives me so much to work with. And so really, it was a joy to draw these guys because they're kind of funny and they're kind of, you know, strange, but they're just so unusual. You just have to kind of, I just wanted to draw characters that kind of draw you in and really engage with you. And Floor, of course, Sweet Floor. I always like to draw a character who has that certain kind of attitude to kind of flow in and be doing something that she would do. And Voldemort. This was the only other drawing that we did of him. And you really don't see him at all. You really just see his hands, his snake, keeping him very much in the shadows and letting you decide what he looks like. Mad-Eye Moody, you know, one of my favorite characters as well, just very stone-like. Tom Riddle. And some of the heads on the wall, Grimwald Place. I think this was the fountain, the Ministers of Magic. And a title page cover of the Potion book. And Harry and Hermione riding off on a dragon into the sunset to set up on new adventures, like we all will here at this wonderful universal celebration of Harry Potter, which is wonderful. And I hope that you all have a great time too. I hope we have some time for some questions as well.
Yes, let's give Mary a big round of applause. All right, let's go down to Jen. Jen, who do you have with you?
I have Katrina all the way from Jacksonville.
All right, Katrina from Jacksonville.
Your question? Hi, what piece of advice could you give to new aspiring artists?
Piece of advice that you give to a new aspiring artist?
Yes, my advice is to keep drawing, to draw every day if you can. And to draw, when you draw, pay attention to how you feel when you draw and what kind of drawing makes you feel good. Because that's the kind of drawing you want to continue to do. You want to draw from your heart. That's when you'll do the best work.
Excellent. Thank you so much. All right, let's move over to Josh. Josh, you have a question for us over there? Who's with you?
I do. We have Jonathan over here.
Jonathan, what's your question for Mary?
Hi, Mary. I was just wondering how or if you interacted with Joe and what that was like.
There was some initial interaction, was there not, when you first started doing the series?
You know, that I met Jill once. I met her. She's a lovely, lovely woman. I met her when she was touring in the States. I met her when she was in Chicago. And usually my contact and the way that I work on a book is really with Scholastic. And they're kind of my team that I work with. So, and they just, of course, run everything by Jill.
Very good. All right. Thank you so much. Let's move over to, yes, Kelly.
Yes, I have Elsa from Virginia.
Elsa. Hi, Elsa. What's your question?
I just wanted to know, what was the most controversial illustration from the Harry Potter series?
Most controversial?
It's controversial. I don't know that there was one. Maybe that's the controversy. I don't remember that there was even one.
What about the most challenging one to bring to an illustration? What do you think?
The most challenging, it actually might have been how to show Voldemort.
Or how not to.
And how not to. How to show the fear and not show the face. I guess that, yeah.
Another one.
And actually just choosing, knowing what scene to choose for each cover is always a very difficult decision to make.
Thank you very much.
Yes.
All right, let's go back to, okay, we're going right back here to Jen. Hi.
Hey, I have Mike from Jacksonville as well.
All right, Mike from Jacksonville.
I just want to say that Gringotts Dragon looks so fierce and angry on top of Gringotts, but I love how you make her look so happy to be free in the illustration. That's amazing.
Yes.
But I was wondering if you had any other mediums that you like using as well as pastels?
On the Potter books, it was just pastels and charcoal, but I also use, in my other work, I use acrylic paints and collage. Yes.
Are you an illustrator? Are you an aspiring illustrator?
I'm a graphic designer, but I've done some illustration, yeah.
Okay, and what's your favorite mediums to use?
I love watercolor and pen and ink.
Nice. I love those too.
Very nice. All right. Thank you. Thank you for joining us today. Let's move back over to, where is Josh? Okay, I see you. Who do you have with you, Josh?
I have Mackenzie from Orlando.
Mackenzie from Orlando.
Hello. I was wondering for you, what's the most special thing that, I don't know how to word it, like, what was so special to you about drawing these illustrations for the covers?
Some of it came back to me today and being here at the celebration and seeing how much they still relate to kids and relate to people reading the books for the first time. And knowing that another generation has come up and connected with the drawings and connected with the writing, of course. And just that's what makes me feel special, being a part of it, is having a part of that in those people's lives and being told that I inspired someone to go to art school or take art classes or to read more. That's, to me, the best part of all of this.
Very nice. Great question. Thank you so much. Stephen?
I have Jessica from San Diego.
Jessica, what is your question for Mary?
I'm curious what artists or architectures or anything has inspired you in your work and helped influence your technique. Style, what got you really into the arts and where you draw from.
So kind of like your inspiration.
Yes.
What got you started?
That's a good question. I was inspired by Michelangelo and the Renaissance painters. And I used to copy their paintings with pencil and color them in with pastel. I used to kind of try to match the master's work to see if I could do that. That was kind of the way I started. And then I just kept drawing, and I just kept getting encouragement, encouraging your kids to draw, and just getting encouragement is such a big part of making, helping a person grow with art, with anything, certainly art.
How young were you when you started?
I started was about 5 years old.
Yeah?
Yeah, actually, I think Mickey Mouse and Minnie Mouse were the very first things I drew, I remember that.
Okay.
Very nice. Great question as well. All right, let's go down to Kelly.
I have Becca from Massachusetts.
Hi, Becca.
Hi. I just want to know how many versions, roughly, that you could do for the cover art of each book, and how those were really decided upon, like which one you would go for.
That's a great question, too. As far as pencils, I mean, I would do maybe 3 or 4 pencil sketches, different ideas for each cover. And, you know, they were pretty big, because they're wraparound book covers, and there's a lot to show. And, you know, I might show the part of the scene on the front, and then show unrelated things in the back, or it might be one complete scene. So we'd have to kind of talk about all that stuff on each version and decide what was best. So yeah, about 3 or 4 per book.
All right, very good. Let's move back over to, yes, Jen.
Hello, I have Lily from Ohio.
Lily, hi Lily.
I was wondering which Hogwarts house you belong in.
Which one I belong in? I belong in Gryffindor. But there's a part of me that wants to be in Slytherin. Right?
Very nice. Yes, I think there's a little Slytherin.
What house are you in?
Gryffindor.
All right.
Gryffindor? All right. Where are the Gryffindors at again? Gryffindors here with us today? Any Slytherin? Slytherin? Hufflepuffs? Ravenclaw?
Yeah!
I thought my bearded friend over there was going to be a Ravenclaw, so not there, but I am. All right, let's move back up to Josh. Yes, Josh.
I have Gabriella from Orlando.
Gabriella from Orlando, what is your question for Mary?
I was wondering how you got involved with Scholastic as an artist.
Well, Scholastic, the art director at Scholastic, had seen my other picture books that I had done and liked the way that I used my color and my light, I think, in particular. And he just called me and asked him, you know, if I was interested. So it was like any job. I mean, we had no idea that it would be this big. And so it was like, that's how most of my jobs come to me. I'm called by an art director. And that's how this one started. It's pretty simple.
Do you think Scholastic at the time had an idea of how enormous this was going to be, or do you think they were just presenting you with all the information really that they had?
I think they told me what they knew, and I think that none of us knew it would be this big. So.
Very good. Thank you so much. Steven, you back out here with us? Where is Steve?
Right up top.
Okay, gotcha. Sorry about that. Lights and I'm on it.
I have Alex from Orlando.
Alex, what's your question?
I was just curious if there was any type of collaboration or inspiration with Warner Brothers when you first started. I mean, you created the Wizarding World for us to see when they started making the films, if they looked to you for inspiration. And on the flip side, you know, once Daniel Radcliffe was cast, did that cause any inspiration for you to change illustrations as you got older and so on and so forth?
Right. Those are great questions. I'm really just being a book illustrator, just really focused on my responsibility as an illustrator for books. And so my focus was, you know, really paying homage to the writing, and anything else that was going on around me was not really what I was focused on. So my job was to read what J.E.K. had written and do my best there, and focus, but that was my focus. Everything else just kind of happened around it for me.
Culturally as well, like when the kids were growing up, their looks kind of changed to adapt what was kind of happening socially with how, you know, like, you know, 10-year-olds was nice cut and clean, and as they got older and they started becoming a little bit more rebellious, the hair grew longer, it was a bit more messy, and that reflects,
you know, were different.
In the book. So was that coming from you thinking that that's how it would normally be, or were you kind of dialed into what was happening kind of socially as well when you would start drawing those, you know, those specific details?
I was more dialed into, I think, my vision as the artist.
Okay.
The books, once I get a manuscript, it's like this whole world wraps around me, and that's enough for me. I don't really need anything else to work with.
Sure.
She gives, you know, it's a complete world that she writes about. So that's all I need.
All right. We got time for one more question, and we'll go right here to Kelly. Who's your name?
I have Colton from Kansas City.
Hi, Mary. First of all, thank you for drawing all this great stuff, because someone else just said, before there was movies for us to watch, we looked to your art to visualize, or at least I didn't visualize what was in the books. And I was just wondering what your favorite overall piece, whether it was a cover art or a chapter art, was that you've done, whether it's because you overcame, like, you know, some illustrator's block, or whether it was just because it was a character that you liked.
Yeah. It's really hard. You know, I have a lot of favorite chapter heads, a lot of favorite black and whites. And each one has kind of a different meaning for me. And I draw my inspiration from the things in my life around me, people around me, you know, as every artist does, things that we see and things we live with. And I've said this before, Hagrid, who I love as a main character, I was very inspired by my dog Chopper, who is a Saint Bernard mix, had that kind of Hagrid thing about him. And so, you know, I love Hagrid, and so Hagrid is one of my favorites because I love Chopper. And so everything has a meaning to me, really. It's hard for me to think. It's like a mom with kids, I guess. As far as the covers go, it's kind of the same thing, but I do feel a certain love, I guess, for the last cover, because it's when Harry is his most victorious, maybe, and it's the last big deal. And so I guess that would be it.
All right, thank you so much. Ladies and gentlemen, how about a big round of applause for Mary GrandPré and her incredible contribution to J.K. Rowling's Wizarding World. I'm sure you all want to know more about how things take to be present. So if you have more questions and you'd like to see Mary at her booth, make sure you stop by Soundstage 33, who's been over to the Expo. If you haven't had the opportunity to, make sure you go and do that. And again, thank you so much for your time here.
Thank you, everyone.